Okay, the Dunning-Kruger effect and assessing kite competency levels. All right, now that's a mouthful. The Dunning-Kruger effect, this is a good one. We see it all the time in ocean sports. It's another cognitive bias or human behavior pattern. And it tends to pop up when people are learning something new or they're surrounded by unfamiliar information. And the short version is, people who are unskilled at something, who are not very good at it yet, tend to overestimate their own skills, knowledge, and ability level at that thing. Okay, so everyone's got the story of that person who thought they were really good at something, whether it was singing or driving or whatever, but they actually sucked at it and didn't realize it. That's the DK effect in action. And the story that prompted Dunning and Kruger to do their study in the first place, this was an extreme case. A guy wanted to rob a bank, so he put lemon juice on his face and he thought that this would make him invisible to the surveillance cameras. So he walks in, robbed two banks, looked right into the camera. Of course, within the same day, he was arrested. We had a guy a few years back come in, wanted to rent kite gear. He says, I'm an IKO instructor, as if that's all we needed to know. First thing he did as soon as he launched the kite was crash it into the trees. So it's tempting for us to laugh at these people, but keep in mind that it can happen to any of us, and it doesn't have that much to do with IQ levels. There are all sorts of reasons, heuristics, blind spots that contribute to this, but as it turns out, us humans are not very good at self-assessment. So when we're learning something new, there's all sorts of information out there and things that need to be learned. Some of it we know about, some of it we don't know about. And the tricky thing, and this has been called the double burden, is that the same set of skills that it takes to become good at something is also the set of skills that it takes to be able to recognize what all those things are and to be able to tell if we're good at that thing or not. And that's a big barrier, because how can we learn something if we don't know what it is that we need to learn, or if we can't identify those blind spots? So not only are we ignorant about something, but we're ignorant to the fact that we're ignorant about it. If you want to get technical, you can call this a lack of metacognition. Okay, so early partial successes often tend to make our consciousness focus on those successes at the expense of the things that we still need to learn and trying to figure out what it is we need to learn. I took a gun handling course a while back, and by the end of it, I could go, yeah, okay, here's the ejector port, here's the magazine release, I can load it. They took me to a gun range, put the paper target about a third of the way down range, and bang, I got all my shots on the target. And they're like, oh, that's great. So I had the feeling, yeah, I can shoot a gun. It's nice to have that feeling, but if you take me back to that gun range and put the target all the way at the end, maybe give me a different gun or a gun that's jammed, or give me a diagram like this and ask me to name the parts, I'm back at very close to zero. And unless I recognize this, I can't move forward. Okay, that sort of thing is what Stephen Hawking meant when he supposedly said, the greatest obstacle to discovery is not ignorance, it's the illusion of knowledge. To varying degrees, and each person's different about this, we have a bit of resistance to being told that we're not good at something or that we have a lot more to learn. It's human nature. Okay, when we hear negative feedback, we tend to put up this subconscious wall against it. This makes it a delicate task to take somebody and show them what these areas are where they can improve and kind of make them realize that maybe they don't know as much as they thought they did and maybe they need to learn a bit more before they can move forward. Fortunately, we have tools and ways of thinking about this. Now suppose somebody walks into your center, they want to take some kite lessons, and they say,
I took about 5 hours of lessons in Egypt and I can fly the kite, I can body drag upwind, I'm just working on getting riding.
So if he says this, then probably in his mind, he's looking at two categories of information. Stuff he already knows and stuff he wants to learn. Okay, now your job is to assess his competency level before you decide what equipment to give him or whether you even feel comfortable sending him out in those conditions in the first place. Now a lot rides on this, because with kitesurfing, there's a high price to pay for mistakes, not only in terms of safety, but in terms of time it takes to recover and sort everything out if things go wrong. We have to take this information here and map it out and break it down with quite a bit more detail. First of all, there's going to be a whole other category of things that he doesn't even realize that he needs to learn. Maybe he's never kited in deep water over his head before, and there's a whole new set of strategies and skills for that. Or maybe he's never had to go out past the shore break, and he doesn't know that he needs to learn about the timing of the waves. Maybe his only knowledge of the self-rescue is somebody talking about it on the beach, and he's never actually had to do on himself. Maybe he doesn't know right-of-way conventions on the water and right-of-way conventions on the beach. We're gonna call these the unknown unknowns. Now let's take a look at the things he figures he already knows. You know, they say, it ain't what you don't know that gets you, it's what you think you know that just ain't so. So there's gonna be some things here in his already know category that his information is either incorrect or incomplete. Good example of that is, maybe he figures he knows how to relaunch the kite, but he's only flown the kite in over 15 knots of wind, and he doesn't realize that in 13 or 14 knots of wind, it's a lot more difficult. Or maybe he knows that if he opens his quick release, the kite will drop, so he can do a self-rescue, but he doesn't know how his strategies for a self-rescue need to change depending on whether he's got a double line flag out or a single line flag out. So we have to take these things and move them back into the unknown unknowns. And all of learning is really about finding these unknowns, identifying them, and from there, turning them into things that we know so that we can move forward. That's kind of what Donald Rumsfield meant when he gave his famous unknown unknown speech. Let's hear that again.
There are known knowns. There are things we know. We also know there are known unknowns. That is to say, we know there are some things we do not know. But there are also unknown unknowns.
Right, so here's how we can start to check to see how much the student knows and at the same time help them become aware of these unknown unknowns. And it's kind of surprising. A lot of people are so confident at this stage that they know what they're doing, that they know how to do this or that. They'll be adamant. They'll say things like, I don't want to body drag, I just want to ride. Don't tell me to fucking body drag because I've been this and the body drag. So we have to kind of open their mind up to what they need to learn in a nice way. So yes, I'm going to talk to him to find out some things. No, I'm not really going to know until I see him with the kite in his hand out in the water. So when we're assessing their level, asking questions, I've got another video with a bit more detail about it here. But remember, yes or no questions are not that helpful. Can you swim? Can you body drag upwind? Can you relaunch your kite? They don't really tell us much because maybe in their mind they can. I had a student once, I said, can you do a self-rescue? And they're like, yeah, what's that? What we want to do is ask open questions about specific things. For example, you're riding along or you're doing your water start, you crash, bam, the kite's on the water, the board's back there. What's your plan? Or please tell me how you check your tuning so that your back lines and the front lines have the right amount of tension. Someone who's overconfident, if they're faced with a question about something that they can't answer, oftentimes that's when the light will start to go on in their head and they'll start to see that, yeah, maybe there's more to it. And they'll start to see those unknown unknowns. Okay? And when you're going to check practically what they do with the kite, what we want to do is observe them as they complete identifiable and measurable tasks. This is a minimum skills check that I give people who want to rent a board or want to practice riding. If they can do this, it takes about 3 minutes, great, we can move on to the next thing. If they can't, okay, we have some things to work on. I'm gonna say, go ahead and connect the lines to your kite, launch your kite, grab your board, go out, ditch your board, show me some power strokes, let go of the bar, let the kite fall, relaunch the kite, go back, get your board, and come back at the same spot where you left from. So I'll draw a line in the beach. That's easily measurable. They either make it back there or they don't. Okay, and like always, we explain it first, then we demonstrate it, and then we let them do it while we watch. And while they're out there, you can look for all these things. Does he go downwind and keep his line slack to start the launch procedure? Is he attaching his safety line only? Is he pulling on the center lines with his bottom hand and holding the bar with the top hand? Is he keeping tension in the front lines while walking upwind? Is he communicating with his helper? Does he find the edge of the window and check the front and back line tension before hooking in? Does he keep tension in the front lines and does he check the back line tension as he's getting into final position? Does he do a 360 degree check before launching? Is there a clearly visible thumbs up? As soon as the kite is launched, does he move directly towards the water? Has he placed his board in his path of travel on the way to the water? Is he walking into the water in a slightly upwind direction to keep tension on the front lines? Is he holding his board above the waves as he walks out? Once he gets into deep enough water, does he shift directly from walking into upwind body dragging without losing tension in the front lines? As he body drags, is his body in the correct position on its side with the hook pointed at the kite and the shoulder at the sky? Is he edging with the board? Can he maintain stable body position even as the wave goes over him? Does he keep the kite at 2 o'clock until he arrives past the shore break zone and in deep enough water? After releasing the board, do you see effective power strokes, sheeting in for a fast turn, sheeting out to accelerate, and then back in again? When the kite crashes, does he let go of the bar and do a 360 degree check? Is he able to relaunch the kite? As soon as the kite is launched, does he put it right to 2 o'clock and start body dragging immediately? Is he scanning around for the board and for other kiters as he body drags upwind? Does he do a shoulder check before changing directions? Can he pass the kite from 10 o'clock to 2 o'clock without getting downwinded? Is he keeping his bottom arm extended in the water until the top hand brings the kite past 12 o'clock? Is he using both hands to stabilize the kite at 10 o'clock before getting into the upwind body drag position again? When he changes directions, does he ditch the board, continue 2 or 3 meters, then turn it and catch the board again on the way back? On the way back in, does he continue edging to stay upwind, to keep tension on the lines? Does he look behind him for approaching waves as he comes in? Does he approach the beach with the kite low so the helper can catch it? Does he unhook as soon as the kite is caught? And did he arrive at least at the same place he launched or a little upwind? Okay, so if your student comes back to the start point with the board in their hand, great. If your student does not come back with the board in his hand to the start point, you've just been given on a silver platter your next 35, 40 lesson points. Because if they don't come back, it's going to be one of those things or maybe something else that you have on your list. Also, the student can see very clearly for themselves whether they made it back to the start point or how far they ended up downwind. And you know 100%, if they don't have all these skills in place, if they're not able to complete this task, they will struggle and waste time when they're trying to learn to ride.
This is where 99% of people at this level go wrong. They become so focused on riding, on cracking the water start, that they've forgotten or they've never learned often all the bits that come before it. This is something we see all the time. This drives me and them crazy. And we practice water starting once because the rest of the time they're just floating up and down while I'm trying to teach them upwind body dragging, which they don't want to learn because it's not what they're focused on. It's not the riding.
And notice this is on 8 meter lines. There's no reason to have them on anything longer because we know trying to teach all these bits and pieces on longer line only takes longer and is more frustrating. So you've mapped out the information, you've helped the student become aware, you've saved them huge amounts of expensive lesson time and got them closer to riding in less time. All this falls under these two basic principles of learning and teaching that we talked about before. Number one, break the information down into small steps. And number two, for teachers, try to be aware of what's happening inside the student's mind. Some more interesting things about the Dunning-Kruger effect. People who are in that unaware zone where they don't yet recognize their own mistakes or lack of knowledge also often fail to recognize the genuine skill and expertise of other people, which could be you, the instructor, so be ready for this. Cultural values have a big influence. People from Western and North American cultures tend to fall for this more. If you're interested in finding out more about this, Stephen J. Hine, psychology professor, has done a lot of interesting work where he compared Japanese people and Americans. So there's a point that we get to where we start to realize, okay, maybe I didn't know so much. If you've studied the 4 stages of learning model, this would be the point where people pass from unconscious incompetence to conscious incompetence. After this, their confidence level tends to drop. And the flip side of the Dunning-Kruger effect is that often people with more knowledge and skills tend to even underestimate themselves. So Dunning and Kruger were the first to collect and analyze empirical data in a scientific way. But throughout history, wise and perceptive people have been observing this. If you stop to read these quotes, you'll see a common theme about recognizing the limits of our knowledge. And there's this.
Socrates. Hey, we know that name.
Yeah. Hey, look him up.
Oh, it's under sew crates. Oh, yeah. Sew crates. The only true wisdom consists in knowing that you know nothing. That's us, dude. Oh, yeah.
And lastly, even experts can fall victim to the Dunning-Kruger effect. One of the most common and dangerous traps is for experts to assume that because they're experts at one thing, that they're also experts at some other thing that seems related. Or they treat fields of knowledge outside their own as a subset of their own knowledge. If there's a word for this, if you like big words, it's called ultra-crepidarianism. And no, it's not from the Urban Dictionary, it's from the Latin. Another one is, the more we know about something, our brains do this to us, we tend to become more rigid in the ways we think about that thing. There's a great video about how our brains work on this. It's about a backwards bicycle. I'll put it up at the end of the video again, and I recommend watching it. So history and the internet is full of experts that have been proven wrong. Thomas Watson, the chairman of IBM, said in 1943, "I think there's a world market for maybe five computers." Even Albert Einstein in 1932 said, "There is not the slightest indication that nuclear energy will ever be obtainable." Our students look at us and we're supposed to be the experts. Who's going to take our hand and guide us through this? Well, all I can suggest, keep in mind that no matter how much we know, there's always going to be a lot more out there that we don't know. Always be learning, learn a new sport, learn a new skill, and we'll keep bumping up against this, and it'll keep fresh in our minds that this happens. We learn from each student that passes through because each person is different. And input from other people in your field is really important. It's good for kite instructors to sit down and talk about their methods, argue about them. I do it this way, I do it that way. We can all learn from each other. This is why we sit down to do after action reviews. And if you're brave enough, organize amongst ourselves peer reviews. What I learned and the conclusion I came to for making this video is that maybe I just don't know what I'm talking about at all.